light peering through a window blurred with frame. Emotions run together in a flood of doubt and pain. We prayed as best we can now. We must leave it in God's hands. Yet I know when mine eyes fail to see, He is able. Even though it seems impossible to me, He is able. Ooh. But if He chooses not to move in the way we prayed He would, confident He's working all together for my good, and I will stand behind His word, for He is able. How many of you believe God is able tonight? Amen. Questions seem to haunt you night and day. How could God allow such pain to come my way? Does He listen when I call, Lord? Is He even there at all? Yet I know when mine eyes fail to see, He is able. And even though it seems impossible to me, my God is able. But if He chooses not to move in the way we prayed He would, we're confident He's working all together for our good, and I will stand behind His word, for He is able. Yes, He is able. And as the night gives way to dawning and evaporates away, I stand to face another day, and I will stand behind His word, for He is able. He is able. God is able.
Hallelujah. Indeed, God is able. Amen. I want to thank Brother Pierre for that powerful song, God is Able. We want to make one adjustment and pleasant good night to everyone, by the way. And even those who are looking at us, are we on us yet, Dennis? Those who are looking at us on Facebook, a pleasant good night to you. There's one adjustment that we want to make, and that starts from Friday night. Right? The adjustment that we are going to make is that the Facebook is going to be shut down from Friday night. So we want you to know that there will no longer be the Real Deliverance extravaganza on Facebook starting from Friday night. So tonight is actually the last night that we will be on Facebook. So all the folks who are looking at us on Facebook, we are asking you from Friday night, we are asking you to come out and be part of the extravaganza right here at the Mova Seventh-day Adventist Church. Invite your friends, your neighbors, your relatives. Let us be together as a family. I know you enjoy the couch and on your bed and so on, and that is good. We are happy to have served you that way. But also we are asking that you make sure that you be here at the Real Deliverance Extravaganza to give God praise with us, all right? And subsequent to the program, we are considering that the program may be on Facebook thereafter. All right, so we're saying from Friday night, there will no longer be the Real Deliverance Extravaganza experience on Facebook, all right? That's the adjustment. We're going to go straight to our theme song at this moment. Let us stand for our theme song.
I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path, I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path, I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. For like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again, sweep away the darkness, burn away chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. There are higher heights, there are deeper seas. Whatever you need to do, Lord, do in me. The glory of God fills my life. The same again. For like fire, soak like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again, sweep away the darkness, burn away the chaff, and let a flame burn to glorify your name. A flame burn to glorify your name. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk a path. The same. There are higher heights. There are higher heights. There are deeper seas. Whatever you need to do, Lord, do in me. The glory of God fills my life, and I will never be the same again. For flow like mighty waters again. let the flame burn to glorify your name. For like fire, so like rain, flow like mighty waters again and again. Sweep away the darkness, burn away the chaff, and let the flame same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk a path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk a path. I'll run the race. And I will never be the same again. And I will never be the same again. And I will never be the same again.
Test. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. We come to you at this time, Father, and we want you to take control. We want you to bless us. Put your words in my mouth. The words that I speak, may be your words. Hide me behind the cross. Let the power of God be seen. Hear us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Good night, everyone. I want to welcome Pastor Ramdat. Just a minute. Okay. All right. Yes, I want to welcome Pastor Ramdat and his wife. And Pastor Ramdat and his wife has become one of us. So I know he's a pastor of the Shogunas district, Shogunas and Felicity. But Pastor Ramdat is Mofa is the second church. I don't want to say the first church. All right, so Mofa is the second church, and you know, you're always welcome. You're always welcome to be here. Well, we have been having some discussions in terms of whether we should continue it on Facebook as well, or whether we shouldn't. I think we should. I was talking to the manager and of the program and so on, and we have to take a judgment call as to continue to send it on Facebook. I know it's a challenge. I know it's a risk. You know, preachers would face that risk. But let's continue to have it. We would look at the data, and so we have to take some risk in terms of, people will stay home and see the program and may not come and so on. Let's take that risk until the end of the program, assess the data so that in the future we will know exactly what to do. Well, one of the reasons why I would like this to continue is that there are some people who are being touched by it. Even some people who may not be even be in the country, may not be even be in Trinidad and Tobago. As from Grenada, There are people listening from Washington, D.C. There are people in a number of areas. So we are weighing some things, but I prefer to lean on the side of being too generous. And let's continue it. But we want to, but here is what we want to do. We want to encourage those who are on Facebook to invite three friends. Invite three friends to be a part, invite three friends to Mova. To Mova SDA Church Facebook. Of course, we're also inviting three friends to listen at this time. But we want to invite three friends to Mova Facebook. And I'll tell you why. After the program, people are still looking. People are still will still be influenced by the Holy Spirit. So it's not that we are having any war in leadership in the program. But, you know, we had our discussion and so on. So we would allow it to continue. And we will assess the data. I would prefer it that way. So we'd allow it to continue, assess the data, and we would move on from there. It is interesting that we last night topic, we had over 1,000 views. And whether those views, we still don't know, even though it's views, we don't know how many people are listening. But we are presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we want those who are listening to connect with God. So this is the challenge to us at this time. Well, let's go right into the message. We want to pray. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father. Father, success is in your hands. Everything is in your hands. But there are persons who ought to make a commitment to God. And I pray, Father, even now, there would be a divine conversation with every person gathered here, every person on the net, every person looking via Facebook, every person who will see it after this program is finished, perhaps someone who would see it a month after, 3 months after this program is finished. I pray that the power of God is going to attend. I pray that you would have a discussion with people tonight. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayer, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Tonight, we are looking at the seven trumpets. God's amazing grace for what? Sinners. God's amazing grace for what? Sinners. And in God's amazing grace for sinners, as we look at the seven trumpets, God is touching Jewish people. He's sending a message of grace to them. He's touching Islamic people. He's sending a message of grace. And he is touching Christians. He's warning the Jews, warning the Muslims, warning the Christians. Are you following me? It's a message, a global message to the world. So let's get in. It's Revelation chapter 8. And we'll go to verse 2. And it says, I saw seven angels which stood before who? God. And to them was given how many? Seven what? Seven trumpets. Let's go to verse 6. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to do what? Sound. So we are looking at Revelation, which is an apocalyptic book. God is communicating the gospels in symbols. When we look at angels, what work would an angel do? By the way, the word translated angel mean angelos or messengers. So what are the work of these messengers? In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 13, it says, "But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool?" Verse 14 says, "Are they not what? Ministering spirits sent for to minister for them who shall be heirs of" who? "Salvation." So people who ought to be saved, angels would minister to them to lead them to the point of salvation. Are you following? So when we look at Revelation chapter 8, you're looking at messengers sent forth to lead people to Christ, to salvation. Are you listening? So let's continue. So we understand the role of the messengers, that these are symbolic messengers sent forth by God to lead people to who? To Christ, to their salvation. The second thing is the trumpets. Why trumpets in the Word of God? Let's go to Ezekiel quickly. Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 1. "And again the Word of God came unto me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of thy people, and say unto them, when I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him for their watchman, if when he seeth the sword come upon the land, he blow the trumpet and warn the people, whosoever heareth the trumpet and taketh not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon" what? "His own shoulder." So trumpets were for what? For warning. Are you following me? Trumpets are for warning, and the watchmen are expected to blow the trumpet to warn people. Because this warning is that an army is coming. An army is coming, and you are in peril. Are you following? So it's a warning. You're being attacked. You're going to be in peril. Another rule for trumpet was in judgment. Let's turn to the book of Leviticus. Leviticus chapter 26, verse 24. "Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing" what? "Trumpets, and holy convocation. And this was the day of atonement." And the day of atonement was a day of judgment. It was a day where the people of God, the people who fear God, must set their houses in order. Because today is a day where spiritually you have to connect with God. You have to ensure that you have submitted to God. Because something is happening. There is a danger. What is the danger? The danger is that this time will pass and you can be lost. Are you following? That this time will pass and the door of mercy will shut. That Jesus, who is your intercessor, that the blood that is now available, somehow you would not access the blood in time. Are you following? So it was a great day of judgment. And the Bible says in Joel chapter 2, verse 15, "Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Gather the people." Why? "Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, and those that suck the breast, let the bridegroom go out of his chamber," etc., etc. Why? Because we are living at a dangerous time. So the trumpets warn that danger is coming, an army is coming. The trumpet calls for, speaks of judgment, and the trumpet is a call for repentance. Are you following? So in Joel, it was a call for repentance. In Ezekiel, an army is coming. It's warning. By the way, they are all warning. Are you following? And in Leviticus, the trumpets talk about judgment. So let's go back to Revelation. So Revelation chapter 8, verse 7, and the first angel sounded, and there followed him what? Hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees were burnt up, and all green grass were burnt up. In the book of Psalms, you'll find in Psalms and in Genesis, fire, you have the work of judgment taking place. In Psalms chapter 1, verse 3, the Bible says, "You shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters that bring forth his fruit in his season." So fire, the execution of judgment. The trees represent who? Someone who is planted by the rivers of waters. The trees represent someone who have made a profession, someone who has made a commitment to God. Are you following? Let's go to another one. Psalm chapter 52, verse 8. "But I am like an olive tree in the house of" who? "God. I trust in the mercies of God forever." So the children of God, the people of God, are called trees. Remember in Revelation, it is saying that the trees were burnt up. Are you listening? So it's talking about judgment on a people that should be the people of God. Let's continue. Jeremiah 11, verse 16. "The Lord called thy name a green olive tree, fair and a goodly fruit. With the noise of a great tumult, he had kindled fire upon it, and the branches of it are broken." God bringing judgment upon Israel. Are you listening to me? It's symbolic language. But as we look at the symbolic language, as we look at other instances, other parts of the Bible, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little, we get an understanding as to what God is saying. Are you following? Jeremiah verse 17 says, "And the Lord of hosts that planted the tree had pronounced evil against" who? "Thee, for the evil of the house of" what? "Israel, and of the house of Judah. They have done against themselves to provoke me to anger in offering incense unto" who? "Baal." These are the people God had planted, the children of Israel. But instead of bearing fruits that would honor God, they have turned from God and they are now honoring Baal. And the Bible is saying, God is saying, "I will kindle a fire upon these trees." Are you listening? Isaiah says, "For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, flood upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed and thy blessing upon thy offspring, and they shall grow up as among grass, as willows by the watercourses," among the grass. So they are also grass. So when you look at Revelation chapter 8, and you see that the first trumpet sounded, there is warning of an army is coming, warning of judgment, and warning, a call to repentance. You understand that there are people who should be called by the name of God, but they are going to be judged by God. Are you listening? So God is warning these people. We know for sure from these passages that God is talking about the children of Israel. Are you listening? Peter says, For the time is come that judgment must" what? "Begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them be that" what? "Obey not the gospel of God." So God has a pattern when it comes to judging and when it comes to warning. Are you listening to me? And you have Peter chapter 4, verse 18. "If the righteous scarcely be saved," well, it's the same thing. "Where shall the ungodly and the sinners appear?" So you have judgment taking place. The first trumpet dealt with the Jewish nation. The Jewish nation that had rejected God time and time again, they had killed the prophets, they had slain all those who were calling them back to repentance. This trumpet is saying, God is warning the Jewish nation, I am saying to you, beware, the trumpet is coming. Judgment is coming. The armies are coming. The devil is creating a situation where you would be destroyed. There is a limit, and you must repent within that limit. Are you following me? And in AD 70, after rejecting Christ, I mean, God came in the flesh and they rejected God. Are you listening to me? So God allowed circumstances to take place, and he allowed judgment to come upon the children of Israel. But before he allowed judgment to come on the children of Israel, he gave a warning so those that are part of Israel who remain faithful to him can have a way of escape. Are you listening to me? How did they escape? Every Christian in Jerusalem. Before Jerusalem was surrounded, every Christian who remained faithful to God, they, my brothers and sisters, they escaped. So when the Roman armies came the first time and miraculously withdrew because something was happening in Rome, the Christian left Jerusalem, and the rest of those who rejected Christ remained in Jerusalem. To remain stubborn and defiant, not only against God, but in the face of the signs of the times. Are you listening to me? So the first angel sounded, and after, and at AD 70, hundreds of thousands. It is estimated that over a million Jews died, and over a million of them were taken in slaves. They were enslaved. It's either death or in slavery. It was a horrendous experience. But not one Christian died in the siege. Why? Because they took the warning. They took heed. They listened to what Jesus is saying. What did Jesus say? When he see these armies, you know that those that are on the housetop, flee. If you're in the field, don't come back. Are you listening to me? And so my brothers and sisters, the first warning, there were people of God who listened to the word of God and they were delivered. Are you listening to me? So the second warning came in Revelation verse 8, and the second angel sounded, and there was a great mountain burning with fire and cast upon the sea. And the third part of the sea became blood. Let me just go back a bit. The reason why the devil wanted to destroy Jerusalem, it was because there are people who were faithful to God there. And the devil wanted to blot out the name of God from the face of the earth. So God was sending a warning to the Jews, sending a warning to the children of Israel, to the Christianity that was still the majority of them in Israel. He is saying something would happen. The devil would seek to destroy you, but I would deliver. So anytime there is a trumpet, there's a way of escape. Are you following? But I want you to understand that even though the seven trumpets sounded, danger continues. So the first trumpet sounded and continued to sound. Are you listening to me? That the devil is still seeking to destroy you. Sometime on a personal level, he is seeking to destroy. And the point is, my brothers and sisters, is that we must take the warning that comes from God and repent, for your redemption draweth nigh. The time for confessing, the time for submitting to God is always in the now. It's always now. Because the devil is on your foot, is stalking you. He is on your heel. He wants you destroyed. Are you listening? So the second angel sounded, and And as it were a great mountain burning with fire cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. Are you listening? And the third part of the creatures that were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. So it seems a little confusing. So let's get clues. Amen. Let's get clues. Number one, we are looking at a great mountain burning with fire. Then we are looking at the sea. We understand what seas mean. Multitudes of people and nations and tongues. So we know that part. The third part of the sea became blood. The third part of the creatures and the third parts of the ship. So let's look. We understand that water, Revelation 17, 15 mean people, tongues. So water, if water means people, then the creatures of the sea and the ships of the sea means resources of the men or the resources of the multitude. So you have the people and the resources of the multitude. Are you listening? So what does the burning mountain mean? Jeremiah 51, 24. You see, the Bible doesn't leave us empty. Gives us clues. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 24. And I would render unto Babylon and to all the inhabitants of what? Chaldea, with all their evil that they have done in Zion, in your sight, saith the Lord. Behold, I am against thee, O destroying mountain, saith the Lord, which destroyeth all the earth. And I will stretch out mine hand upon thee and roll thee down from the rocks, and will make thee a what? Burnt mountain. So the mountain, a burnt mountain, is a nation being judged by God for persecuting his people. Are you listening? I want you to understand that when you talk about the seventh trumpet, it is stretching from John's time to the end of time. We established that in prophecy. From John's time to the end of time, not before John. So we had the Jews being judged, the children of Israel, Jerusalem, being burnt to the ground, being judged by God. First trumpet. Second trumpet is what? It is somebody, it is a nation that has persecuted the people of God. God is going to judge them. Are you listening to me? Which empire in John's time and after John's time is persecuting the people of God? The Roman Empire. It's the Roman Empire that had the majority of the people of God. The scripture, my brothers and sisters, was entered in the Roman Empire. Are you following? Jesus was born in the Roman Empire. He died in the Roman Empire. The disciples died in the Roman Empire. They were persecuted. Thousands of people met their death. The lives of the saints were used as entertainment. Rome and the Roman Empire were the persecutors of the people of God. They were savage persecutors of the people of God. Sometimes pregnant Christian women were placed in these stadiums and they were hooked up and labor would be induced, and dogs would be waiting underneath to devour the children before them. Are you listening to me? Persecution took place, but God is always mindful of persecution. I'm saying to you, sometimes you're fighting for God. Sometimes you're standing for God and persecution happens. I want you to understand that those who touch the people of God are in more danger than the people of God. For while the people of God may be facing men and demons, the people who persecute the people of God are facing God himself. And the best person to fight for you is God. There's nobody could stand against God. God will never be outdone. Are you listening to me? And so God, when all the persecution is taking place, when all the deaths and the slaying of the Christians are taking place, God had it in his mind, I will deal with this empire. Are you following me? And Rome had her judgment. And when that judgment came, Rome was like a burning mountain. But why was God blowing a trumpet? Why? Because there were people, there were children of God in Rome that must escape. And the devil in the midst of the judgment is seeking to destroy both the righteous and the unrighteous. But God is seeking to save the righteous. Are you following me? There will always be a way of escape. My brothers and sisters, there will be temptation, there will be struggles that you will be going through, but God will always provide a way of escape. When the temptation comes, what we should ask for, Lord, what's your escape? I'm prepared to surrender to your way of escape. Are you listening to me? Jesus is coming, my brothers and sisters. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is coming. And the coming of Jesus is the great escape. We should be asking ourselves, how can we be prepared for the escape that would be facilitated in the coming of Jesus Christ? The Bible says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the remission of your sins. Are you listening to me? So Rome was awash with the gospel, and Satan wanted to destroy Rome, not because he was angry at Rome, but he wanted to destroy the light of God. So God, beforehand, top secret, is blowing a trumpet warning the people of God. Are you listening to me? But then Satan changed strategy. If Satan can't kill you, he'll want to join you. If he can't destroy you as an enemy, he'll try to destroy you as a friend. Are you following me? So something is going to happen in the third trumpet. Let's go to verse 10. And the third, you see, because in the first trumpet, he did not succeed by seeking to annihilate all of Israel. He did not succeed in destroying Christianity. By destroying Rome, he did not succeed in destroying genuine Christianity. So the devil is now changing his strategy. Let's follow what he's doing now. Revelation chapter 8, verse 10, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great what? Star from heaven. Something is falling from heaven. What do you think fell from heaven? Think about it as we continue. A great star fell from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the what? Third part of the rivers, upon the fountains of waters. And verse 11, and the name of the star is called what? Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Wormwood. It's a poisonous plant. So the star fell from heaven into the water. What does the water mean? The people. So let's look at the clues again. So to the angel, there's a great star falling from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. It fell on the third part of the rivers, third part of the waters. The star is called wormwood. Third part of the waters, many people died. In Luke chapter 10, verse 18, Jesus himself said, I beheld what? Satan fall as what? Lightning from where? From heaven. He's falling as light from heaven. Are you following? Revelation chapter 12, verse 3, and there appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon, and having seven heads and ten horns and seven crowns upon his head, and his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman that was ready to be delivered, to devour her child as soon as she was to be born. In verse 9 it says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole earth. He was cast out into the what? Earth. And his angels were cast out what? With him. So what is cast out into the earth? It's the devil. The star in the third trumpet is the devil himself. Where is he falling? He's falling on the waters. First, the devil is attacking from the outside. Now he's coming from the inside and operating. Are you listening? So what, and he said, what does water mean again? He says unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the horse sitteth, are people and multitudes and nations and tongues. But what are the fountains of waters? And the fountains means a supply or a water source. Jeremiah chapter 2 verse 13. For my people have committed how many evils? Two evils. They have forsaken me, one, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out, what? Broken cistern that can hold no water. So the first thing is, they reject the water of life. Then they hew for themselves broken cistern that can hold no water. So it's an illusion. Are you listening to me? Let's continue. Jeremiah 17 verse 13. O Lord, the hope of Israel, all that forsake thee shall be ashamed. They that depart from me shall be written in the earth, because they have forsaken the what? Lord, the fountain of what? Living waters. Revelation chapter 21 verse 6 said, I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is a thirst of the fountain of waters of life freely. So the fountain that God wants us to drink from is Jesus Christ. So when in Jeremiah they rejected the fountain and hewed for themselves broken cistern, they're rejecting Christ and going to sources of water that did not give them water of life. Are you following? Here we have, my brothers and sisters, we have in the Bible, in the third trumpet, that the devil is falling on the waters, but he is also contaminating the fountains, the sources of life, the sources of truth. Are you listening to me? So the devil began to change his strategy. And I want to tell you, the Bible says in the last days, that the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried in the last day, that's of a feast, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believeth on me, as the scripture had said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living what? Waters. So the Bible is saying, follow me now, the Bible is saying, he that believeth on me, as the scripture said. Therefore, you have to believe the scripture to believe on Jesus. Are you following? So the rejection of Jesus was the rejection of scripture. So Satan came into the church and sought to cause the rejection of Jesus and the rejection of scripture. Are you listening to me? So after the Roman Empire, while the devil began to change his strategy, the devil's focus was to cause the church to reject Christ and to reject scripture. Turn from following the dust, saith the Lord. Get your own opinions. Get your own ideas. Have your own philosophies. Are you following? And so, in the third trumpet, right after the division of Rome, you saw the dismantling of Christianity. Are you following me? In the third trumpet, bit by bit, with silence, and then more openly, as it increased in strength and gained the control of mind, the mystery of iniquity was carried forward. So after the dismantling of Rome, the church is now changing from the word of God and trusting other philosophies. Are you listening to me? And the Bible here is warning the church that you are embracing error. You are not embracing truth. Are you listening to me? So outside of the church, they had these the pagan priesthood of Dagon. The pagan priesthood of Dagon was always in a fish symbol. Are you listening to me? You know, whenever I hear, and sometimes you see on movies and cartoons and so on, the Christians making the sign of the fish. Christian never made the sign of fish. That only happened in the later centuries when the corruption is taking place. The people who were interested in making the sign of the fish were non-Christians. Are you listening to me? So from the Canaanite religion, you had the prophet, the god Dagon. Dagon was always in a fish symbol. And the priests of Dagon would have a mitre with an opening to the top like a fish's, the mouth of a fish. Are you listening? So in the Canaanite period, even at that period, they had a priesthood. Remember, I spoke to you last night, and I think it's two nights before as well, that after the Tower of Babel, you had the priesthood, and you had certain families spreading to different areas. Are you following? So after this, these religions continued, and then it from the Canaanites, it continued in India, it continued in Egypt, and in Babylon, and therefore when Greece overtook Egypt, the practices of the priesthood of Egypt melted into Greek society and Greek religion. And when Rome overtook Greece, yet embraced all of these practices, the priesthood that influenced Greece also influenced Rome. In addition to that, the Babylonian priesthood moved from Babylon to Rome, not far from the Vatican. That was their headquarters. So the priesthood of Dagon continued. And so the priests of Dagon would dress like this. Are you listening? So when you look at the wear of the Pope and the priesthood and the Vatican system, there is no different. Any historian who would have a little understanding of the priesthood of Dagon and the Canaanitish religions and the religions of Egypt and the religions of Babylon would see a striking similarity. Are you following me? So you have the priesthood of Dagon here. Follow me now. And the striking similarity. Are you listening? Are you following me, my brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen? I'm not trying to be harsh. I'm looking at history. And I'm looking at the movement of pagan culture through the church. As the church is moving from its source of truth, the Bible. So these, the priesthood of the church began to be promoted to a level that the priest is now God. Are you following? But the priesthood of the pagan Romans, they were called God. They had mass, and in their mass they would have a wafer. I mean, you can just do some investigation, okay? So you have the priesthood of Sibyl, and the priest of Sibyl, this is what they would wear. Are you listening to me? They were very powerful in the Roman Empire. When the church began to compromise, the priesthood of Sibyl, the goddess of Asia Minor and Syria, and that was actively involved in the Roman Empire, began to influence the church. Are you listening to me? As the church loses, as the church moved away from following scripture, the church is now following something else. And God is warning the church. You're going to be destroyed. The devil is now coming in and he's contaminating the whole source. And he's warning the people, don't embrace these false doctrines. Are you listening to me? So these are the pagans. Pagans. The pagans. This is the Christian. Are you following the development, my brothers and sisters? The priests of Dagon, who wore this mitre, this is the priest, in honor to Nimrod as a fish, because Nimrod came as a fish to them, reincarnated in the sea, the papacy wears the same mitre. This is the true successor of Nimrod. When Elijah went on Mount Carmel, Elijah faced the priests of Dagon. And Elijah said to the people of Israel, choose you this day. How long will he halt between two opinions? If Baal be God, then serve him. If God be God, then serve him. Make a choice. He is facing the priests of Baal. The priests of Dagon. Are you listening? It is the same priesthood that has come down through the ages. The successor is the Pope. It's the same doctrine. The same doctrine of Immaculate Conception. It's the same doctrine of Marianism, where Mary is not simply the mother of Jesus. She's a co-intercessor. Intercessor. She is the Queen of Heaven. She is God. Are you listening to me? It has become so popular. The standoff on Mount Carmel is now reinvented. The standoff that we are seeing now and we will see in the near future is a standoff between the majority and the minority. Between Elijah and the priests of Baal. My brothers and sisters, God is blowing the trumpet. He is saying, choose life, choose truth. Are you listening to me? Even though sometimes, oftentimes, most of the times, truth is not popular. Choose truth anyway. Sometimes truth isn't nice to listen to either. But it's only the truth that will set you free. Are you listening to me, my brothers and sisters? So these prophets of Baal on the Mount Carmel, by the way, even at that time, they would be worshiping on Sunday. Are you listening to me? Sunday was a popular day. Since Nimrod's time, Sunday has always been a popular day for worship and the serving of the deity of the sun. So when all the former president, and at that time, the present president knelt before the Pope, it said something as a Protestant nation. Are you listening? But God, during that time, there was also the rejection of the Sabbath. The church moved away from the thus saith the Lord as related to the Sabbath, and the church embraced an authority that the church did not have, and the church moved the solemnity of the Sabbath from the seventh day to the first day. Are you listening? That's no secret. They have said it over and over again. So God said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor, and on the Sabbath day he would bless it. He would sanctify it. He would honor that day on the Sabbath. That day, the Sabbath. And next thing that came in, as I said before, a next error that came into the church, and another pollution, another pagan input was the mass. Where the Hebrew, the pagan deity would be reincarnated in the pagan festival. Are you listening to me? I want you to listen to this. I'm talking about these things happen after Rome was dismantled. The church church is experiencing this. The church is losing. The church is letting go of truth. Why? Because the devil is on the inside and they are not holding faithful to Jesus and to Scripture. Hence, the priests are called the parents of who? Of Christ, of Jesus Christ. This is not me, my brothers and sisters, I'm quoting. Such is the title that St. Bernard gives them, for they are the active cause by which he is made to exist really in the consecrated host. The priest becomes the active cause for the existence of Jesus Christ. Are you listening to me? Thus, the priest may, in a certain manner, be called the creator of his creator. Since by the saying of the words of consecration, he creates as it were Jesus in the sacrament by giving him a sacramental existence and produces him as a victim to be offered to the eternal Father. As in creating the world, it was sufficient for God to have said, "Let it be made," and it was created. He spake, and they were made. So it is sufficient for the priest to say, "Hoc est corpus meum," and behold, the bread is no longer bread, but the what? The body of Jesus Christ, and that is the power of the priest. Are you listening to me? That's pagan practice. It's in the church by the urging on of the devil. Then you had Marianism. Mary, the mother of God with a sacred heart. That's pagan. It is only refined to suit the Christian audience. So everywhere it had Marianism. Oh, what is really the Madonna and her baby? So it had the black Madonnas. Then it had the Chinese. They have the white, they have all kind of Madonna. So when Madonna, the singer, took the name Madonna, are you following me? She is taking the name because she is an active priest, priestess in the whole concept of Madonna worship. Are you listening to me? She is an active priestess in the worship of the Queen of Heaven. Are you listening? So here she is. So you have Ishtar or Isis, actually, in Egypt, being melted into Christianity. Are you listening? Then you have the Indian version with Mother Lakshmi and her son. These are pagan practices that the church embraced, and God was warning the church because there is a price for embracing error. Are you listening? You would not be without, will go unscathed if you embrace error. So we have the same hands. Listen. The worship of the devil is universal. Are you listening to me? It is just reincarnated to suit the different cultures. But it's universal. But God is setting his truth so that even those who have been deceived would find an escape. Are you listening? So you have Baphomet with his hands like this. But you have the same thing here. Are you following? Ladies and gentlemen, church began to embrace a number of principles. So when you see Kenneth Copeland talking about on the cross, Jesus won the right for the believers to be born again back to the God class. Are you following me? Adam was created not subordinate to God, but as a God. He lost it and Christ died. And in Christ, we are taken back to the God class. And he concludes by saying, you have a God in you. You are not one. You don't have a God in you. You are one.
Right.
Are you following what I'm saying? That the church, because the church is not following scripture, the church is embracing error, and the church is being dismantled by the devil. The devil is working from the inside. So you have, at this time, the church, this man is asked some questions. And we won't go into it because we don't have time. But people are actually laughing at him because he's talking about the coming of Jesus Christ. The religion of the world, the Christian religions, are laughing at him because he's talking about the coming of Jesus Christ according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, according to 1 Corinthians 15, according to Revelation 1:7, according to Matthew chapter 24, Matthew chapter 25. They are laughing at him against the dust in the face of the dust, said the Lord. Something is happening and God is sending a warning. So you have the snake being glorified again. Even in the throne room of the pontiff, you have the snake there. So you had some precious deviation. One, the original sin. Two, Marianism. Three, the Pope, the Vicar of Christ, and he is infallible. Four, Sunday sacredness. Five, the law is done away with. Six, children baptism, which is connected to original sin. For if children are born with the guilt of Adam, then children ought to be baptized. That was the conclusion. Are you listening to me? Seven, the worship of the saints and the gods. All of these things. And God was blowing a trumpet. He's saying, beware. There's danger. Satan has changed his strategy. He's now working from the inside. In the fourth trumpet, Revelation chapter 8, verse 12, and the fourth trumpet sounded, and part of the earth of the sun was smitten, and a third part of the moon, and a third part of the stars. So the third part of them were darkened, and shone not for a third part of it likewise. So they are talking about darkness. Darkness taking place. So right after the fountains have been contaminated, right after the devil is working in the church, and all types of foul pagan doctrines have come into the church, darkness is taking place. Are you listening? And what is being darkened? The sun is being darkened. Are you following? In Matthew chapter 4, when he answered, let it be written, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded from the mouth of God. So here we have a number of texts where Jesus is saying he is a light. Are you following me? And the word of God is also a light. Jesus is the truth. He is the way. He is the bread. He is the life. He is the word of life. Are you following me? The Bible talks about making two great lights. In Malachi chapter 4, verse 2, but thou shalt fear my name, thou that fear my name, shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and he shall go forth and grow up, and he shall go forth and grow up like as calves of the stall. So Jesus is the Son of Righteousness. What is darkened on the fourth trumpet? Light. When Satan gets into the mixture, darkness happens. Are you following me? When we turn away from scripture, there's darkness. Darkness on a personal level. In your soul, there's darkness. Darkness on a corporate level. The church has darkness. And when the church moves away from the word, the church is in darkness. Are you following? So Jesus, in the fourth trumpet, the warning by God is given. The devil is going to work after he has contaminated the truth, after he has moved you away from scripture, after he has turned your attention away from Christ. The devil is going to work to create darkness. You shall not understand the mission and the role of Christ in terms of ministry in terms of ministry to you. And during that period, we still call it the Dark Ages. Are you listening to me? The work of the Holy Spirit, the work of the angels, the work of Christ is being overlooked. There's darkness. It has become savaged. Are you listening to me, my brothers and sisters? So God must now bring back light. So the fifth and the sixth trumpet, I will go through them quickly. There's something else happening. So God speaks a warning, gives a warning to the Jews. He gives a warning to the Christians. To the Jews once, to the Christians twice. Because the devil is operating in Christianity. It has darkened Christianity. The fifth trumpet. And the fifth trumpet sounded, and he opened the bottomless pit. There's an angel, and there rose a smoke out of the water, out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air was darkened by reason of the pit. Well, we already know who the sun is. The sun is Jesus. So the devil now is working in an additional way to take away the understanding or the knowledge of Jesus Christ and his importance in your salvation. Are you listening to me? So in Revelation chapter 9, verse 3, and out of the smoke came locusts. And it was commanded that they should not hurt the grass, neither any green thing, neither any tree, and only those men who have not the seal of God in their forehead. The only way to survive is to be sealed by God. Are you listening to me, my brothers and sisters? Revelation from chapter 9, from 6 to 8. There you see the locusts, and there's a description of the locusts. The locusts, they are at war, 9 and 10. They have breastplate. They are an army. They have the power to hurt for 5 months. Are you listening? Let me break it down. In prophecy, a day is a what? A day is a year. So a day equals a year. So 5 months in prophecy, in the Jewish reckoning, 30 days for a month. So 5 by 30. Are you following? So it's 150 days or 150 years. Are you listening? Something is going to happen. It is armies that will be coming, and it will be symbolized as locusts. And these locusts, this whole operation would obscure Christ. The ministry of Christ. After they are finished, the ministry of Christ would not be so effectively seen. Are you listening to me? So when you decode this passage, you'll have in Joel chapter 2, verse 25, I restore the years that the locusts have eaten, and the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palm worm, my great army which I sent among you. So it is a large army. Follow me now. Follow me now, my brothers and sisters. Satan fell. But now, something is going to happen for 150 years. What is happening for 150 years? What is going to take place after the church is now full-blown in pagan rituals and doctrines? What is going to happen? What happened in history? The first Islamic invasion. Are you following? The first Islamic invasion came, and it lasted for 150 years. They conquered many territories. All of these areas, when the hordes of Islam came, so powerful was Islam that after Islam came, all of the Middle East was Christian. After Islam came, you could hardly find Christians. Even though at some times Christians were protected, but their work was always diminished. So for 150 years, and the Bible says that's a problem. Are you following? and the role of Christ is a true and faithful witness. He is now reduced from God to a mere prophet. So the work of Christ in the sanctuary for sinners is not even looked at. That truth is totally obscured. People are going to a Christless grave not knowing the truth. Are you following me? In the sixth trumpet, you had the next operation, and that took place for over 300 years. It's the same locusts, but they are now more devastating. It's the same Islam, but more devastating. Are you following me? But in Revelation chapter 10, there is a mighty angel that stands. This move on the power of Islam continued until 1844. Are you following me? And ladies and gentlemen, there's an angel that stands. Remember I said the angel swears. So this angel is not a mere angel. This angel is God. It is God saying enough is enough and re-establishing his truth on the earth. His foot, one foot is on the sand and one foot is on the sea. And God is now taking, well, he is always in control, but now he is standing. Now he is getting so actively involved in drawing people back to him. The Bible, which had been taken from people, is now printed. People, the Bible is now flooded everywhere. And we are living now in the sixth trumpet. Are you following? And in the sixth trumpet, God is giving a warning. The warning is that in the sixth trumpet, Jesus is coming. Are you following? Be prepared for the coming of Jesus, because the seventh trumpet is the actual coming of Jesus Christ. Are you following? Read it in Revelation chapter 11. The sixth trumpet, Jesus is about to come. There are signs being foretold over and over again. But in the seventh trumpet, Jesus himself is coming. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to let you know today, Jesus is coming. The sixth trumpet is sounding. Anytime Jesus comes, it's finished. It's the seventh trumpet. Because according to Revelation, when the seventh trumpet shall sound, the mystery of God shall be finished. His work of saving mankind is finished. So for 2,000 years, God has been calling, God has been pleading, God has been warning us over and over again. Reject truth. Understand that the devil is working in your midst. But now he's saying, this time is almost at an end. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, why be on the fence? How long shall we be on the fence? Jesus is about to come. And when he comes, the opportunity would have passed. You have to make a choice now. That's the call for you to make a choice tonight. Because he's coming. And when he comes, ladies and gentlemen, when he comes, he is going to take off his priestly robe. There is no more pleading for sinners now. When he comes, that priest who is pleading constantly for us, who liveth to make intercession for us, the intercession would be over. Are you listening? So that's why the priest is warning, calling us back to his law, calling us back to his Sabbath, calling us back to his truth, calling us back to the cross, calling us back to Christ. It's a warning. Because the next trumpet is Jesus coming in the clouds of glory with 10,000, with millions of his angels. He's coming. The time for making a choice is now. Are you listening to me? Why put off this thing? Why continue? I'm talking to those in the church at this point in time, and those that may be looking at us on Facebook. The time for coming to Christ is now. Because the next trumpet you would hear is the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and that would be the final trumpet. And at that time, mercy is no longer. So now is the time. While Jesus is seeking to get us, now is the time. And when Jesus comes, we want to meet him as Lord and Savior. We want to meet him as a group of people who have already given our entire lives to him. Are you listening to me? We must be able to say, this is our God. We have waited for him. And he's here. Tonight, I'm making a call. I want you to stand. Pray for somebody tonight. Pray for somebody on the net. Pray for somebody in the church. Pray for somebody tonight. Because God has already warned the world. He warned the children of Israel. He warned the Christians that were in Rome. He warned the children of God against the first Islamic invasion and the second Islamic invasion. He warned, but he's also warning even Muslims, saying that while he warned Christians that the devil is in the church, he's warning Muslims, saying the devil is in the movement. And at this point in time, God is calling people to make a stand for him. Let me say something just before I make the call. Some truths, they are brutal truths. I get it. I get that they are brutal truths. But these truths are only brutal because we have gone so far away from the truth. So we are so far away from the truth, when the truth comes, it is brutal. But truth was always designed for our salvation. It's the truth that will set you free. Don't hate the truth. Hate the one that propagates error. Are you following? So the call tonight, you've been here, some of you have been here, perhaps some of you are here for the first time. But I want to say to you, if you have heard the voice of God during these meetings, if you know that it is truth, if you're saying, I want to be prepared for the coming of Jesus Christ, I want to give my heart totally to Jesus Christ, at this time I'm calling you, come. You want to give your heart to Jesus Christ. You want to totally give everything to him. You want to submit to his will, submit to his law, submit to his leading in your life. Come. It's a call to follow his truth. It's a call to be ready for the coming of Jesus Christ. It's a call to be baptized. Come. Come. Bless the Lord, my sister. Is there somebody else who will say, I want to stand on the side of truth? Come. I'm calling for people who ought to give their hearts to Jesus Christ. Give their hearts in baptism. Come. Is there somebody else? Somebody else here. You would say, I want to stand on the side of truth. I want to be baptized. I want to submit to God. I want the rule of God's law to be the rule, to be ruling in my heart. Come. Come. I want to sing all to Jesus, I surrender. Sing all to Jesus, I surrender. Because I know there's a challenge. I know the pressure. Because you see, coming to Christ is a changing of your life. I'm not going to fool you. I'm not going to pretend that when you come to Christ, well, you know, you just have to make a little change and come to church. No. Coming to Christ is giving over your life to Him. And whatever He says, you do. He tells you to change, you change. And while saying, you know, you don't have to stop doing this and you don't have to stop doing that when you come, you know, I can't do that to you. So yes, when you come to Christ, you give your entire life to God. You are saying, Lord, reorder my life, reorder my thoughts, reorder the way I think, the way I behave. That's what you're saying. But I want to show you that the power is there. That will help you reorder your life. It is He that worketh in you to will and to do His good pleasure. It is He who does it. And I want to challenge you. For every person that commits themselves to God, He gives them the power to change. Are you following? He will always give you the power to change. My own personal experience tells me, and I'm assured, and I can tell you with 100% that when you come to Christ, there is overwhelming power given to you to surrender, to change, to be transformed, to live as He wants you to live. He is loving. He is caring. He will do whatever it takes for you to be powerful and for you to be a victor. He will do whatever it takes. So you're coming to a God that will fight for you more than the devil could ever fight for you. God is more ferocious than the devil. Let God be on your side. Just one verse again, and we'll close. One verse again. I surrender all.
I surrender all.
I surrender all.
I surrender all.
All to Thee, my this Sabbath, a baptism would take place. Is there anyone here who would say, I want to be in that baptism? You may not feel prepared. The issue would never be how you feel. Make a choice to be with God. Is there anybody else? After this verse, we will close. Is there anybody else?
Let me feel
the Holy Spirit.
Oh,
truly know that Thou
art mine.
I surrender. I surrender all. The call is now. The time is now. Surrender everything to Jesus. All to Thee. My blessed Savior. I surrender all.
I surrender all.
Let's pray. Let's pray, Heavenly Father. When people decide to give their entire lives to Jesus Christ, for Jesus to reorder their lives, it's an awesome thing. You have given prophecy to us to warn us about and expose how the devil works. Those who take the warning, like the Christians who took the warning when Jerusalem was surrounded with armies and not one of them died, so even today, if we take the warning, if we submit our lives to Jesus Christ, if we embrace Christ, we would not be destroyed, but we'll be saved when Jesus comes. Tonight, Father, bless my sister, bless my brother tonight. Tug at somebody's heart. Explain to somebody. Share with somebody. Lead.